Good afternoon to most of you, and good morning still to those of you calling in or joining from US. I'm the last speaker here, and thanks for raising expectations. Let me see what I can do to conclude. I have tried not to compete with all this discussions and presentations we have had during an exciting day here, but go a little bit into the helicopter and look at the cities from different perspectives. I think first of all, it is real. I think some of the early speakers this morning already raised it. The planet, the life on the planet is at risk, and also that society is waking up by this. I'm also stating this is the link to cities. This is where we have the citizens. This is where we facilitate the businesses. This is where we have the government, the politicians. So I think this is a fact. If we had discussed this a couple of years back, situation and conclusion would have been different. I think a conclusion is that we need to rebuild, or somebody might say reconstruct, society. And in my opinion, it needs to be based on cities, and therefore also I think the cities project, but also what is called the triple helix approaches. Bloomberg stated before COP21 in Paris, cities act while nations talk. I think this is still the situation. There's a lot of discussion, but if those of you who will participate tomorrow will also learn, because I'm gonna talk tomorrow about what cities or in Denmark municipalities actually do. Cities can frame and facilitate stakeholder participation. I mentioned already some of these stakeholders, but cities are people, and people need easy advices, directions, and therefore cities need answers to solutions, to the policy setting, but also society participation. How do we engage? How do we ramp up? How do we engage not only citizens, but also important stakeholders? And I think that the triple helix approach, where university, where industry or company or business work together with government and politicians, actually is the approach that can help this ramp up these actions. I think from a city perspective, it's very much about overcoming complexity. There's a lot of complexity in what I have learned today. And I know you're all masters of this, but if we just shared it with city, so-called city experts or city planners, I think many of them would probably be a little bit scared of the amount of information to digest. So this, how can we make it simple, simplify, how can we overcome complexity, I think is a very important message from the cities. And the cities project itself have been supporting many such transitions. I will mention a few that I know of, but already cities, municipalities have been mentioned, Middelfart, Ringkøbing Skjern, Høje Taastrup, and Sæby. There has been several, and which also reflect that cities has not only had a theoretical approach, but a practical approach. But also, I think the triple helix have challenged the cities project itself and how we have been working with the cities. And let me share with you a couple of examples here. The first one is, you could say, cities had a challenge we discovered, I think, back in 2015. And how we use this approach to overcome barriers. I think first of all, and thanks to Henrik and the team around you, Henrik, for creating cities. Cities had a science objective, society objective, education, and then there was business. Why was there business here? Because I think, Henrik, your orientation always have been, let's look outside the university, let's work close with business. But we discovered in 2015 that actually only the three elements, science, society, and education, did support the work packets 1 to 7. So how did we, in a smart way, connect the business with the innovation that we wanted? And the answer, as simple as it might be today, I think it was really an interesting learning that we need to define, we need to work deep, and we need to connect the research and the business with the demo, and thereby also have a very strong, create a very strong connection to society. I think therefore also cities became an enabler for new business innovation and also growth. What are cities hungry for? Growth, what are politicians at national level or global level looking into? This is growth, or how can we recreate growth? We also managed to take this learning into, we work with, somebody might know, the this business approach, the balanced scorecard, where we mapped very efficient how we were working with work packets 1 to 7 and what was important. And I think some of the observations we found was that especially the external partners, the business partners, had some challenges, so to say, if I'm not wrong in my memory, connecting and delivering and supporting some of these processes mentioned here at the third level. We mapped the business participation here, and I think out of this came, we need to connect with cities, we need to connect with city networks, but we also mapped the demo, and here you can see how that actually created a much more, not only complex, but much more holistic picture. And I think for tomorrow's discussion in Golling, especially the data part of it, I think we started looking at, we need to really care more about the data, and out of that came also other inventions. I think it concluded this study here that the business domain meets the research domain and creates in cooperation new green demo scalable city solutions. And I think therefore, I think the city have been very successful seen from the outside point of view, from a city or from a business perspective. A lot of the learnings and knowledge that we have shared or listened to today, reviewed, is only inside brains and the network here, but I'm very happy and pleased that at least 25 city solutions have been documented in during the last 12 months and are easy to read, to digest, and relate to decision making in cities and in society. So that was how you could say Triple Helix have engaged in cities, but how did cities then engage in urban climate transition? Apart from what we already have learned, I would like to give a couple of examples from Sønderborg. This is where I have my daily life. I'm trying to understand bigger pictures, but my focus is on Sønderborg. In Sønderborg, our vision is to contribute to this climate challenge and solutions, and we do this by combining the climate solutions required with the job creation, and also always having in mind that what's important for the city, for the politicians, for the citizens, for the people, the businesses operating here, one of them is, by the way, Danfoss, is the good life, unless we always remember that we also here to integrate the good life and keep that very ambitious, I think we fail our transition. We have had a long journey so far. The journey started 2007. And here you can see on the lower line, you can see a lot of activities within the city. You can see initial years, it was very focused on pieces of technology. Then we realized it was maybe not only about technology, but about people, young people, people in all kind of positions, situations in life. And at the upper line, you can see how we have dealt with foreign policy, so to say, of the municipality. There has been a lot of Chinese, there has been a lot of US. We have been working with the Clinton Foundation. Now it's C40, and we have continued a very strong journey with EU and EU projects. So what are we focused on from a climate perspective? We are trying to take 700,000 tons of carbon emission generated by citizens and businesses and public institutions having their operation in Sønderborg, and the count was 2007. We want to make that zero. Zero or one ton of carbon was a little bit uncertain for most citizens until we created this balloon 10 meters in diameter containing exactly one ton of carbon. And then people are really surprised with what's going on and how could that happen and how can we contribute. So I think part of it is making it the invisible visible. You can see here the journey so far, a 44% reduction have been achieved by 2019, and the goal is within a couple of key milestones to reduce carbon emissions by 100% to be carbon free by 2029. We started our journey focusing on houses. Houses, buildings have also been important in the cities project. I remember a lot of our initial discussion was focused on houses. We just built a house. It could have been built 35 years back because technology was available. But here was the first house in Denmark that had no carbon emission because of solar panel, because of heat pump, because of installation, because of training of the people. But it had a major impact on people living here. And we had visitors from even China and US going to see that house that could have been built many, many years back. So why didn't we do it? Some excuses was it was probably too expensive. Somebody would say battery storage was not available. So why build such a house? I think prices have gone down. Battery storage is available. I mean, technology will fix and cure some of these concerns. We also managed to influence Frank Gehry doing a Frank Gehry Harbor project at that time. If we hadn't had the house as a role model, it would never have happened. Some of the team have talked about strategic energy planning. We also in Sønderborg do strategic energy planning minimum every 5 years. It's about getting people on board. It's about sharing a vision, working out the details. We defined a process as part of an EU project and working with partners from the cities, how it could be done and replicated in other cities. And the ultimate outcome of that was, this is our roadmap 2025, not about what me and my team should be doing now, but what whole society, local society are busy doing, executing these projects. It's complex. And first time I saw this sketch here of the energy system, I had to find out, okay, where's energy efficiency? Okay, that's on the right hand. Then I felt safe. Okay, there also need to be energy from renewable. So we need heat pumps. We need electrical vehicles. We need electro fuels. It was, I think, for most of us who was not used to this actually very excellent template created by university here and was used for our energy modeling on an hourly basis until 2029, where we need to be zero carbon. How will these 52 initiatives, projects help turn Sønderborg zero carbon? It helped us overcome this uncertainty. One last example here is sometimes things just happens. And then somebody placed a recycle and reuse of waste center in the core of this island, which is a core of our municipality. Then somebody added district heating production. Then came wind turbine not far away. Then a couple of years back, it just happened that there was a huge PV park added nearby. This autumn, 2 months back, a huge biogas plant, one of two new biogas plants were added. And now we look into a unique opportunity to make this an entire construction to consolidate and make it resource efficient and also create new demo facility and at the same time open it with data for our kids and our university students. You can see some of the pictures added here. What we are looking at right now is how do we harvest business? How do we harvest, create more business? How do we create new jobs? We have found out that the link between the left side here, which is the transformation of Sønderborg's energy system, and the right side of this where you see the business, is actually a demonstration and also continue our international promotion, which you saw. And I think actually realizing that this demo activity at a local level, which was, I think, what Henrik wanted us to do at national level, and I think also it's always, as I think also inside Danfoss company, there's a saying, seeing is believing. So when you go and visit these demo places, demonstratorium, I think you really have a unique opportunity to deliver your message. Let me come to the conclusion here. Being a CITES partner since 2014, some of us had known each other a little bit longer, has helped me, has helped Sønderborg understand the language. It has helped us overcome the complexity. It has helped us build the demo projects. It has helped us understand why we need data. And I think the whole world is exploding in data. Tomorrow we have an excellent conference focused on the next step of the data, and also facilitate whatever discussions we have had with climate neutrality and stakeholder workshops. And right now we are looking for, so what's the next step here? We need not to see this as the end of the world, but as a start of a new beginning. So these pictures here is my last slide. It's I think some of them goes back to 2014. Some of us, Henrik maybe, and Pierre looked a little bit different at that time here. But I think what we just have listened to today just reflect and illustrate there's a lot of knowledge here. It also reflect there's still some jobs to be done here. Politicians are lacking behind. Maybe our language, as I said, have been a little bit too technical, maybe, but this overcoming the tax system, mental barriers, and also connect to this real-time carbon taxation, which have been a major theme during the day, I think is important. This is not the end. This is just a comma, you could say. Then the journey will continue. Some of us continue tomorrow, will continue into new networks, new partnerships and new projects. And I would like to take this opportunity and thank everybody for letting us on board. This has been a very powerful and fruitful cooperation so far. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. This is exactly it. This is not the end. This is very much the beginning. And thank you so much for giving a view of how you locally and globally have actually converted cities in a project that you have been able to use from business perspectives and a citizen's perspective, and making this, so to say, converted into real-time life. So there's a lot more to go. And for me, it just is a matter of summarizing up the day. We have now come to the end of the final CITES program of today. And as Peter just said, the program will continue in Kolding over the next day. And the program can be found at Green Digitalization. I guess Hannah is just putting a short line in the chat. I guess you do need to sign up if you would like to join this conference as well. Online is possible. Yep, it is there. Thank you. And for me, it just needs to sum up the whole day. We've got a glance over the extraordinary amount of work that has gone into this project over the last 7 years, with so many results, with so many excellent people all across the globe. And there is still a lot of work to be done, because we haven't yet been, we haven't not, haven't yet been able to be 100% fossil free tomorrow, which was a provocative statement when the project was granted back in 2014. But I guess we are well underway, but there is a lot of work to be done, and the whole trick is in the detail, so to say. The devil is in the detail. If we are to succeed, this, all these fantastic research and products, etc., need to be expanded much more largely. Though companies, universities, researchers, cities are well acquainted already with this. And it is a global challenge, which this program very much shows as well. For me, that's just to say thank you to all the speakers, to all the listeners who are still out there. I also would like to extend a specific thank you to Hanne Kokkegaard, who has done a very large job making this program happening, also changing it from a real conference to an online conference. She has worked basically around the clock. So thank you to her. And then there's for me just to hand over to Henrik and let the last comment come. But I would like to applaud you all for having been here for today. And thanks, Henrik.
Thanks a lot, Anne-Marie, for excellent chairing of this final consortium meeting of cities. As also indicated by Peter and you, we don't stop here. First of all, the city software solutions will be on the new long-lasting cities webpage, so we can still continue to download software solutions and data. We will also continue to work very, very closely together with the new national initiative Center Denmark Unilab DK, which is in fact very much inspired from the ECIF facility where Ben Kropotsky is a director in NRL. So this is the new digital innovation hub, and a lot of the solution will be anchored on the Center Denmark. I want to thank all our friends in Croatia, Australia, Korea, US, Australian, Ireland, Spain, and also all the national partners for participating in this, this project. I think we have proved that we have taken a step, an important step forward towards the fossil-free future, and we have shown that digitalization and sector coupling, energy system integration is the way to go. As also said by many of you, this is a part of a new initiative called Green Digitalization. And we will continue with Green Digitalization 2020 tomorrow, together with the Flexible Energy Denmark project and the DIPSIS project in Kolding. So you will learn more tomorrow, also from the Cities project, but also from some of the other projects. Next year, it's my intention that we should also work together with leading projects like Heat 4.0, the new Cool Data project, and a lot of new European projects related to this important part of digitalization and sector coupling. And I think that as Carl, it has been a little bit strange seeing that in the morning we start with people from the Korea, where we actually saw our friend from Australia for the first couple of hours. And now we are together with our friends from the US, on the west coast of the US. And but even though we have had some restrictions here, as Carl said, Carl from Aalborg University, I think there has been a lot of good flow and a correlation between the talks, and I really enjoyed all the messages here. I also think that what we have heard from latest year Small, Peter and Ben Koborski, with the cheap wind solar power and the new possibilities for trading and the city's absorption of the results, things look very good. So thanks a lot to everyone. Hope to see you soon physically in the future, and see many of you tomorrow in the second day of this green digitalization, where City is one of the partners. Thank you.